Tom Cavanaugh was born on a clear, unseasonably warm day in late March 1982. He was the fifth child. Though his father joked with the older kids that Tom was the tiebreaker, the one who put the count to three boys versus two girls.
Yeah. How old are you this year, Tom?
Five!
Tom eventually landed right in the middle of nine children. It was a family that friends and neighbors knew for its strong sense of community and even deeper commitment to faith. Sunday mornings would see the entire Cavanaugh brood piling out of multiple cars into the church parking lots of Our Lady of Mercy or St. Gregory's Parish. Church first, hockey later.
When he was two, he used to go out in the driveway and shoot balls and all by himself because he imitated his brothers. And from then on, he just loved hockey and he always was focused on it.
Because nearly as strong as their faith was the family's commitment to a small black rubber puck. And on the frozen ponds and white salt-worn asphalt of Warwick, Rhode Island, Tommy fit right in. Sometimes his older brothers would brush him off, but Tommy would go about happily entertaining himself, taking shots against the garage, or making up his own game of one-on-one.
We didn't fight. Tommy didn't fight with his brothers and sisters. If he did fight with a brother, it would probably have been his younger brother, Dave, and that was to protect him from picking on Jimmy.
So it was funny, he was the oldest of the young kids and the youngest of the older kids. And so for me, especially my brother Dave, the two younger boys, he was really the guy, our big brother that we looked to. I mean, Joe and Paul, they were always just a few years older. So Tommy was the one I really have a lot of memories of growing up as being the oldest guy in the house.
Because we had older kids and I was coaching them, I didn't notice Tommy when he was little. And then people started to talk to me about, hey, you seen Tom? He's special. Then when I started to coach him and spend more time, I said, oh boy, we got something.
Later he'd scratch and claw his way into Warwick Junior Hockey, but he didn't have to prove himself for long. It was clear to everyone that the little guy, as his brothers like to call him, was a natural athlete with all the makings of a star.
Growing up in our circles, he was a much better athlete and a better hockey player than everybody he encountered.
He was a gifted player. I mean, he had a great ability to see the game and understand the game.
In fact, he sort of made hockey look easy. And hitting a fastball didn't seem too difficult either. After establishing himself throughout the junior league as someone to watch, Tom moved on to play for Tollgate High School, his local public school.
He took a path that not many people take. Most kids would go to play prep school, kids of Tommy's ability, or go and play junior hockey someplace. We had an extraordinary coach in high school. He stayed and he played with his teammates and stayed with them throughout the whole time.
For me, and I don't throw superlatives around a lot, and probably should throw more than I do, but he really was perfect. He, as a high school hockey player and as his coach, he was really a perfect guy to have on the team.
On the home ice at Thayer Arena, he became known for his slick moves and soft hands, but even more for his humility and his generosity on the ice.
Tom was always by far and away the best hockey player I knew. And he didn't carry himself like you think someone with that talent would, or he never thought he was better than anyone.
And not that he was a guy of a lot of words either. So when he said something, it meant that.
We used to play teams. Mount St. Charles in high school was way better than Tollgate. And we would lose 9-1. He'd say the next day, oh, I can't wait to play them again because we're better than they are. And that was his attitude. So it was always fun to be. And I think when you hear the teammates liked him, it was because he brought everything to the rink.
Tom earned All-State honors and captured the individual scoring title in his junior and senior years at Tollgate.
Every team had a guy. And he was our guy on a team of good players. Tom was one of our best. And then his last few years there, his junior and senior, he was by far and away. Anyone, his teammates, coaching staff, fans, the man that drove the Zamboni in the rink, everyone knew he was, that he was really, he was a very, very good player.
From there, he went on to sharpen his skills and, in spite of himself, earn more fans at Phillips Exeter Academy, where he set a single season record with 42 goals.
Well, you know, I've been doing this for 31 years. I've been coaching kids age 17 to 19. And I can say that he's the best player I've coached.
Well, his first game at Exeter, he scored 6 goals.
He wasn't the kid who was the biggest or the fastest skater or looked the prettiest, you know, had the nicest style. He was just the most effective.
At Exeter, there were other good players, and the pro scouts started to come to watch those other players. They didn't even know who Tommy was. And through that experience, the scouts started to see Tom, and then he got drafted.
Over the years, I've said to my son, who's now 15, he's heard me describe Tommy as the only perfect hockey player I ever coached. His teammates thought the world of him because they knew he was the best player, yet he had a modesty and, you know, so his teammates loved him. I've always referred to Tom as a coach's dream.
From there, it was on to his father's alma mater, Harvard University.
What really impressed me about Tom was there really was no ego to anything that he did.
At Harvard, Tommy was at once humble and hungry and very good.
All the talents, all the work ethic, and you know, all the team first attitude that you would hope to have, not only in any player, but you know, it's a blessing when it's you know, it's your best player.
During his Harvard career, he played every single game, a feat that had never been accomplished before or has since, and led his Harvard team to 2 ECAC championships and 4 consecutive appearances in the NCAA National Tournament.
10 seconds in, it is Tom Cavanaugh, who has played so well throughout the postseason.
He hurt his knee his senior year at Harvard.
But he was still putting up points. He was still our best player, both ends of the ice.
He thought it was a hyperextension, and for 6 weeks he played without any brace, without any protection at all.
And it was, you know, a full ACL deal and, you know, one of those knee injuries that takes almost a year to recover from. He didn't waste a second. He turned to coach, you know, I can play on this, and you know, I want to finish out my senior season, and I want to be there for my teammates. And I know it makes the story sound greater, but you know, there we were that night, you know, in overtime, and who knocks in the game-winning goal?
Tom Cavanaugh wins it in overtime.
You know, I get emotional even thinking about it, but he was a first-class kid, and if I had a fault with him, is that he was tough to a fault, which is really not a fault in the game of hockey.
Although he was the perpetual center of attention, as a college star, Tommy retained the team-first mentality he had displayed as a kid. He was everyone's friend and played for the love of the team. As far as Tom was concerned, honors and distinctions were meaningless when achieved alone.
There are certain kids that, as a coach, you learn lessons from. Absolutely, I would say I learned a lot from Tommy Cavanaugh.
His talent and grace eventually earned him the chance to play at the game's highest level in the NHL, despite a college knee injury. Tom was not someone who was easily defeated.
That first impressions, you might kind of write them off, and I think maybe that happened in his pro career a little bit with people who maybe put him in a certain category. I think maybe his coach in Worcester came to realize that Tom actually was better than he looked.
By Stevenson, puck in front, score! Cavanaugh! And the Sharks take the 1-0 lead.
As a draft pick by the San Jose Sharks, Tom came up the way most players did, first making his mark in the minors. In his case, the Worcester Sharks, San Jose's top minor league team. Tom took Worcester by storm, eventually amassing 138 points over a 4-year career and becoming Worcester's all-time points leader.
You put him in a battle for a puck and, you know, 9 or 8 out of 10 times he's gonna come up with it. His will exceeded his skill. He would follow his shot up and get second, third opportunities and will the puck into the net, you know, like actually no one else I've really coached.
In 2008, he finally got his chance to play with the big boys. And like always, he was more than ready. 37 seconds into his first NHL game, a Sharks record, Tom floated an assist to Joe Thornton.
And the Sharks still have the pressure on. San Jose, a shot and score by Thornton from a bad angle. Tom Cavanaugh just got signed, and he does get an assist, and he's got his mom and dad and a lot of friends back in Warwick, Rhode Island, tuned into the game tonight.
Ask him about it later, and he'd modestly shrug it off.
You know, that's what you look for in a hockey player. His biggest example is how he left everything out there on the ice every game.
Devin Setoguchi, he's got 30 goals in front, and Tom Cavanaugh scores his first National Hockey League goal. There's the man of the moment, Tom Cavanaugh, with the first goal of his National Hockey League career, and for Tom Cavanaugh, it comes in just his 16th game.
Stick down on the ice, and look how smart he is, how he turned the blade.
Although Tom's first love was hockey, his favorite season was summer, especially along the Rhode Island waterfront. He loved being around friends and his ever-growing family of siblings, their significant others, and the nieces and nephews he adored. For Tom, an afternoon spent cooking out and playing wiffle ball down at the beach was better than any achievement on the ice.
I was 8 years old and running with a dime in my hand to the bus stop to pick up a paper for my.
Tommy, I think, of all of our kids, was focused on hockey, but he also had other good instincts about people, and that's come out a lot from teammates.
We had some great laughs. Tommy was funny. I haven't mentioned that much, but he was a funny kid, and he had a great sense of humor.
He really taught me that it's not about what other people think of you. It's about what you know about yourself. And that's something I've always tried to really carry over in my life, and in all things. And it's really amazing how humble and selfless he really was.
Bravo! Bravo!
It really is. A lot of people, I think, don't believe it or think we blow it out of proportion, but he really was just a selfless kid who just wanted to be friends with everyone, and like, that's Tommy.
Tiny tiger. He definitely doesn't look too happy.
As a son, brother, and friend, he touched so many without even trying. He gave everything he had of himself to everyone he loved. Then, and still. Unbeknownst to even those closest to him, despite Tom's public accomplishments, he quietly waged an internal battle against mental illness for most of his adult life. In his mid-20s, this struggle became more acute. He sought treatment, surrounded himself with the love and support of his family, and applied all he had to improving his health. Nevertheless, his condition only continued to deteriorate. On January 6, 2011, Tom succumbed in his battle with mental illness. While Tom is no longer with us in body, his spirit lives on to teach and guide us.
This is an area where people could really help. I mean, financially, they could help support-wise, educating others, programs in high schools, colleges, just get people more sensitive to the fact that mental illness is a reality. It's not a popular topic to talk about. It's not popular for people to support it. And it's so needed, and it's important to kind of get over that hump and get people to say, this is a reality, we have to deal with it, let's deal with it the way we deal with other things.
Just the stigma kind of about mental illness, it's like, ooh, like, it's kind of an area people don't really talk about, or kind of like generalize that if someone's mentally ill, they're crazy, and kind of a stereotype, I think, for mental illness patients. So I think what I would like people to walk away with is the fact that mental illness does exist, and it's actually a disease that affects your brain and can change who you are.
Mental illness is an illness. It's a chemical imbalance or something that's caused by injury, and it's really prevalent in our society, way more than people know.
Tom was sick. There are so many others out there that are also suffering from mental illnesses, and many of these people can be treated. It is estimated that 1 in 4 Americans will suffer from a diagnosable mental illness in any given year.
One of the major challenges with Tommy was getting help and seeking treatment and taking medication. All these things he was embarrassed by. He didn't want to be somebody who was sick or had to go to Butler Hospital. He just wanted to be normal.
I guess another message for people who think they have mental illness to not be afraid to get help. Hindsight isn't 20/20, and who knows how much that could help my brother, but maybe it'll help someone else.
Mental illness in our society is prevalent and relevant, and if diagnosed and treated properly, has better outcomes than heart disease and cancer combined.
We hope that people will become more aware of people who don't have any support and need financial help at places like Butler, because there are a lot of people at all walks of life who have these problems. And I mean, in a way, Tom was lucky because he had family and support, etc. But there are many people who don't have that.
Many who suffer from this illness lack the resources to receive adequate treatment. Even in the midst of his inpatient stays at Butler Hospital in Providence, Rhode Island, Tom always appreciated how fortunate he was to have people in his life to help him get the care he needed, while so many others he saw suffering from this illness did not.
The more you get the message out there that anybody can be affected, and most families are affected by mental illness, the better. And I think that ultimately is going to be the greatest accomplishment in Tommy's life.
It is the hope of the Thomas G. Cavanaugh Memorial Fund that Tom's story will continue to bring much-needed awareness and financial support to the fight against mental illness.